like to present a small panel on focusing, in both cases, on Latin American populisms. So first is Alberto Moreiras from Texas A&M University.
Thanks, Joe. Well, I'm very happy to be here, as I think the Populismus project is indeed very important, and I am proud to have become a part of it. The last 2 days have been a steep learning curve for me, and of course I thank Yanis and his team for their generous invitation. I want to try to incorporate, inadequately no doubt, the discussion we have had, or at least a part of it so far, into my presentation. It's not easy because I am very conscious of time, and I came up with a 30-page paper that I will have to summarize very drastically. But I can offer to send anyone the paper if they want it. So just, you know, you just need to ask me. Here I will concentrate on trying to get some things across as clearly as possible and to state my position on some of the issues at hand. If I had the time, I think I'm not going to have the time. I would have liked to conclude moving from the notion of the forceful Indianization of the Bolivian state, I'll tell you about that, to what is being proposed by some elements of the Podemos leadership in Spain right now, which is the Indianization of the global left. So I would have liked to move from the Indianization of the Bolivian state to the Indianization of the Bolivian left. But I really don't think I'll have the time to get into it. But we can perhaps address it briefly in the discussion if you want. So when yesterday Yanis was restating the minimal conditions or criteria for populism that the project has so far established, and talking about the existence of two fundamental intellectual and political camps, namely populist and anti-populist, I realized I count myself among the populist in the populist camp if we go by the two minimal criteria, that is, if we consider that populism is a dimension of politics, as Francisco Panizza persuasively stated yesterday, that includes a prominent reference to the people and a partisanship for an always expanding inclusionary democratization of the political process on the basis of an also explicit antagonism towards the enemies of inclusionary democracy and democratization. The elite, the casta, the 1%, we could expand this. University administration, for instance, the bureaucrats, corporate interests, their accomplices, and so forth. But there are two additional elements that could be discussed as minimal criteria for a definition of populism. Cristóbal Rovira persuasively argued against one of them yesterday, namely charismatic verticalization. It also came up in the previous panel. And today, now, I will be arguing against the second, namely, what I would call the identitarization of the political field. We can, of course, argue against both of them all we want, verticalization or identitarization. But the issue is whether they should be considered essential to the definition of the populist dimension. The Populismus project is rejecting that option so far. Perhaps in the very name, of distinguishing what we could call good and bad populisms. But the problem of good and bad populisms goes, of course, well beyond the traditional split between right-wing and left-wing populisms, which Yanis presented yesterday, but you just limited yourself to that, right-wing or left-wing populisms. I think I should say, in order to fulfill my promise, that I would try to present a clear position that even if all right-wing populisms are bad, whatever that means, whatever bad means, there are also bad left-wing populisms. And I think we need to start thinking about those things. So what does bad mean? If the criterion is democratization of the political field, there could be left-wing populisms that become a threat to the democratization of the political field, betraying what they may have originally claimed to uphold. We also talked about this just before lunch. I think charismatic verticalization of the political process and identitarization of the political field are two elements of bad left-wing populisms. And it is clear they have affected, although perhaps not terminally yet, some of the ongoing populist regimes in Latin America today. So it seems to me the task of critique is urgent for that very reason, and not renounceable. We cannot afford not to speak about it. If ongoing and expanding democratization of the political field is the goal, then we need to critique the tendencies or deviations that lead to an institutionalization of both verticalization and identitarization, even if and when those two processes are done by left-wing populisms, in the name, presumably, of fostering the first two minimal criteria. Let me put it this way. If populism must include verticalization and identitarization, then I am anti-populist. If populism does not have to include them and can in fact avoid them, then I am a populist. And the discussion so far has been a bit ambiguous, right? Yesterday, Yanis presented a splitting, a heuristic splitting, that had to do with the fact that right-wing populisms tend to become, or always already are, I quote from him, nationalist, racist, authoritarian, while left-wing populisms are, I quote, inclusionary and democratic. But what happens when left-wing populisms, once in power, start moving towards nationalism, racialism in some form, and authoritarianism? Must we still support them? And up to what point? Where is the point of no return? Where is the line? This is a political problem for me. It's an urgent political problem, I think, for any Latin Americanist. But I want to say it is a political problem at the level of conceptualization and definition, not at the merely empirical level of, say, betrayed promises. In other words, the real problem is if populism must always move, when successful, into verticalization and identitarization, that's when we have a problem. Not if somebody betrayed a promise or somebody goes rogue or somebody, you know, makes a mistake. If that is the case, I think populism must be rejected to start with, and not only when it inevitably becomes the betrayal of a promise of inclusionary and radical democracy. And then, if we must abandon populism, because it inevitably, structurally, leads towards verticalization and identitarization, we must find some other name for the kind of performative radical democratic politics that Yanis was calling for this morning. Right. The problem is very much alive today, not just in Latin America, by the way, also in Spain, where the leaders of Podemos are already embracing political positions that set them on the way of charismatic verticalization, as Alexandros was discussing before, and identitarization, this notion of the Indianization of the global left, self-consciously on Latin American models. I don't know enough about the Greek process. So I have limited time remaining, and let me use it to give you three brief glimpses into what I think is the case, taking Bolivia as my example. I will start by reading a quotation from Jeffrey Weber, a Marxist political scientist that has devoted a lot of serious work to Bolivia. I think the quote, which is not just about Bolivia, but it is also about Venezuela, is very significant. Jeffrey Weber says, "It is plausible to contend that Venezuela has not even entered a revolutionary epoch at any time since 1989, much less achieved a political or social revolution. Instead, Venezuela has witnessed a series of rebellions from below, with wide-scale popular participation, and other actions from above, with lesser popular participation, which have forced significant concessions from factions of the ruling class, produced significant changes in the personnel of state management, led to the transformation of some old political organizations as well as to the creation of new ones, and allowed for major social improvements through the distribution of a greater share of the oil rent to the popular classes in a context of high oil prices on the world market. By comparison, the left indigenous insurrectionary process that unfolded in Bolivia in 2000-2005 arguably constituted a genuine revolutionary epoch, which overthrew two heads of state through mass mobilization. This surge from below, however, has been partially contained by the government of Evo Morales and has thus far looked, therefore, like a political revolution emerging as a consequence of an aborted social revolution. Weber presents, therefore, the constitution of a national popular regime under the mass government in Bolivia as an example of containment, as an example of revolutionary containment, which means, regardless of what it means at the level of political economy, politically, it means that the Morales-García Linera regime has consolidated itself into a successful and viable national popular regime, a national populism, in the name not necessarily of expanding political revolution and ongoing radical democratization, rather in the name of containing, taming, orienting it towards a specific modality of hegemonic order. That construction of hegemonic order goes in Bolivia today very much through an identitarian ideology. I am interested in how García Linera, from the vice presidency, which is not a trivial space, has pushed the identitarian ideology in a nationalist sense. In fact, he says that what has taken place under his government is the Indianization of the Bolivian state. We can take a look at his 2014 book, Identidad Boliviana, Bolivian Identity, because that's the book where he very most clearly addresses the theme of identity. You can download that book, by the way, from the website. García Linera publishes books like 3 times a year. I don't know how he manages, but he does, and then he puts them all on the website, and you can download them for free. Bolivian Identity is a book that stems from a political conjuncture. I will not bore you with that. It is a response to a book by the leader of the opposition, Carlos Mesa, about mestizaje, which is something that García Linera despises. I think rightly so. But what he's talking about, and there is an extraordinary phenomenology of identity. I will let you have some examples of that a little later, in the first 30 or 40 pages of the book. And then a crucial moment arrives when García Linera expounds on the fact that, I quote, the very indigenous social organizations conjured away the possibility of self-determining tendencies for the indigenous nations. The attribution of agency to the indigenous social organizations functions as a matter of national common sense, García Linera says. It is well known that nations with a greater historical vitality, it's interesting that he would use this kind of 19th century discourse, right? Tend to lean toward the constitution of nation states, as it has happened in various parts of the world. Indigenous organizations, García Linera tells us, could well have chosen to go their own way and declare themselves independent, but they chose not to. History went another way, he says. And then this is a long quote. Constructions of cultural hegemony, of the articulatory skills of the indigenous movements followed, to say it in some way, a path more Gramscian than Leninist regarding the state consolidation of indigenous identities, in such a way that instead of opting for indigenous national self-determination, which would have meant the separation from Bolivian identity, the struggles flowed towards the option of the Indianization of the state and the growing Indianization of Bolivian identity, as the site of unification of the diverse indigenous and non-indigenous identities in parallel to the cultural re-strengthening of that very same indigenous identity. A Gramscian model. Identities add themselves through seamless articulation in order to constitute a yet stronger identity constellation. The strength of identity is itself presented as a political palliative and a true accomplishment, even if the final referent of identity is the non-identity of a newly invented object, an object invented by the mass government, the Bolivian plurinational state, non-existent before 2009. This is no doubt a strong, even if paradoxical, discourse on identity. not a proposal, but an affirmation of the triumphant Indianization of the Bolivian state through the creation of the plurinational state of Bolivia. A very strong sentence follows: whatever is Bolivian becomes real the moment the state Indianizes itself. Indianization is to be defined identitarily. But what does that mean? It may well be true, as an outsider, self-reflexively so, I am in no position to adjudicate the more than superficial accuracy of the final claim below, that today, I quote, today in times of Evo Morales and the social movements, neither whiteness of skin nor cultural whiteness concentrate privilege. On the contrary, as demonstrated by the mechanisms of formation of new prestige and new merits in the selection process of civil servants in the plurinational state, exhibiting indigenous belonging or the sponsorship of indigenous organizations are the most sought after at the moment of looking for office, from military command to legal court or parliamentary structures. This speaks in favor of a rapid devaluation of the colonial ethnic capital and even of asserting Indianization of the legitimate qualifications in the face of the state. So, I will summarize, running out of time. A political revolution would have been accomplished, and the content of that political revolution is the identitarization of the Bolivian state. It only remains to be seen whether a social revolution, a true change in political economy, for instance, a fundamental reversal of the ownership of the means of production, can follow suit or is already doing it. But even if the social revolution has not taken hold yet, politically speaking, democracy proper may no longer be needed. It has already happened, at least as majoritarian or popular democracy, as identitarian democracy. And yet, the fact that all of this is premised on the triumph of cultural identity claims makes one hesitate, or makes me hesitate. We have rhetoric in García Linera's book that talks about the identitarian state, identitarian density, identitarian consistency, primordial hegemony, whatever that means, primordial hegemony. Okay? From the primordial identity of the human, he says, identity is the fundamental aspect of being in the world. I think Heidegger will be turning in his grave. From the primordial identity of the human to the primordial hegemony of the state. The primordial hegemony of the state. Is that the secret and the truth of democratic politics as such? Is nationalism and nationalist closure the ultimate configuration of the political for the national popular regime in Bolivia today? Please note that the issue is no longer indigenous identity. The issue is substantialization into national identity in the name of indigenous identity. I think there is a problem here. I still have 2 minutes, right? Identity is always potentially totalitarian. García Linera is clear enough. To identify oneself is a way of valorizing oneself and at the same time of valorizing and devalorizing others. Identities, to a greater or lesser degree, have an effect of permanent hierarchization and conflict in the social space. National popular Indianization hierarchizes, values and devalues, and defines and reifies the human in terms of its plausible degree of identification with national identity itself, in its hegemonic version, which is now presented as primordial. García Linera's discourse on identity may have as a primary function a politically conjunctural one. The sojourn of his government's national popular project as the final horizon of Bolivian political democracy. Every hegemony, we have always known it, wants to be eternal. I'm going to leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we move on for a second time to the to Alexandros Skiopkolis, part two.
Thank you. Thank you. First of all, I want to say that I feel a bit intimidated because there are many important experts in Latin American politics in the audience today. And I'm a newcomer to this field, but I'm more than willing to hear your critical comments at the end. I will talk about the case of Venezuelan populism and Chavez populism, who was one of our main case studies in the populism project. The other was Argentina. We all know why the study of populism in a Latin American context is very important, because it has been a historical cradle of populism in the 20th century, and also a very important influence in the construction of the ideal type of populism, due to the protagonistic role in populist politics of charismatic leaders such as Perón or Vargas in Brazil, and their direct unmediated relationship with mass followers. Now, this, as we have heard also today, this Latin American populism has been explained as a side effect of a particular flawed process of modernization. But what is very interesting in more recent times, in the 90s and the early 21st century, is that we have a reappearance of processes or situations of social and political exclusion, and again, an attempt through new forms of populism, that many of them were left-wing populisms, an attempt to recover popular sovereignty and promote social inclusion. So it's a form of a resurrection of the earliest Latin American populism, but in a different context. Now, this populist comeback in Latin America has been received in different ways by different commentators, politicians, and political analysts, and so on. Some people have argued that it has indeed promoted popular empowerment and the renewal of democracy in Latin American countries, where others emphasize that we see, again, the same tensions between a populist style of populist on the one hand, and on the other hand, liberal rights and democratic procedures. The same division appears forcefully in regard to the case of Chavez populism and Chavismo, and we see again the same divide between people who argue that Chavez contributed to a process of radical democratization and inclusion of excluded social sectors on the one hand, and other commentators and analysts who argue for the opposite. They argue that Chavez actually and his policies was a doom for liberal democracy in Venezuela. What I will try to argue is that we don't need exactly to choose between one or the other position or to simply try to find a middle way among them, but I will actually endorse both positions. And I think that, according to my understanding of this form of populism, that Chavismo has been an inherently contradictory and heterogeneous, many-sided phenomenon, which constitutes a transitory process in response of the crisis of established liberal democracy in Venezuela. My argument in the populism project constructs Chavista populism as a site of tension and struggle, whose final outcome is still open and will be decided through ongoing political struggles. Accordingly, in my view, this is a process, I mean the process of Chavista populism, is a process that contains both promises and dangers for contemporary democracy. And to make these points, I have drawn on what I consider a valuable shift in the contemporary study of populism in Venezuela, an ethnographic turn in the study of populism, which pursues field research and engagement with the grassroots movement, the grassroots of Chavista populism, instead of focusing exclusively on the figure of the leader. Now, my first point, which shows a continuity between Chavez populism and the populism that left-wing populism that we find today in Europe, is that it has been from the very beginning a response to what we call the turn to post-democracy. Post-democracy is an impoverished figure of liberal democracy that has emerged among a variety of constitutional regimes from the late 80s onwards, under the impact of the hegemony of neoliberalism and the gradual dissolution of programmatic differences between mainstream parties. A post-democratic regime sticks to the formal shell of liberal and democratic institutions, but popular participation in party politics, mobilizations, trade unions, and so on is on a chronic decline. And sovereign power slips into the hands of corporate and political elites. Material and political inequalities rise to the detriment of ordinary working people. At the same time, popular disaffection with the political system cannot find its way through established institutions and seeks extra institutional discharge through protests, revolts, or extremist parties. In this respect, the crisis of liberal democracy in Venezuela, which was exacerbated in the 80s, is parallel to similar developments in Western Europe and more recently in the European South, such as Spain and Greece in the last decade. In Venezuela, a relatively functional liberal democracy was installed in 1958 after the fall of a military dictatorship. It was grounded in a pact, an agreement among political and economic elites who agreed to uphold a liberal constitutional regime, and in that respect, Venezuela was an exception in Latin America. It had a stable liberal democracy since 1958 and avoided both authoritarian deviations but also deep political conflicts. This regime and this agreement was called the Punto Fijo Agreement. A two-party system crystallized over time with the Social Democratic Acción Democrática and the center-right Christian Democratic Copay Party taking turns at power. The regime was consolidated in the 70s, enjoying high rates of development and a relative affluence that was thanks to the oil rent. However, it was afflicted by widespread corruption and political patronage, while easy access to credit on the back of the oil revenue helped to raise sovereign debt to great heights. In the 80s, a financial crisis set in, and the government was forced to implement austerity measures in exchange for IMF aid. So this is a situation that has many parallels with what has happened in Greece and Spain, and in Greece in particular. The two ruling parties converged on the same neoliberal austerity policies, and towards the end of the 80s, the established liberal democratic regime had become overly corrupt, elitist, exclusionary, and unresponsive to popular demands. Rising popular discontent could find no outlet within political institutions. In 1989, it burst out in a spontaneous mass revolt against the elites by poor people from the barrios and working class districts in Caracas and all over the country, which was bloodily repressed. And this is widely considered to be the first revolt against neoliberals. Despite ongoing indignation and two failed coups in 1992, social disaffection and pressure failed to produce any substantial changes in policy making and the political system. The demand for effective political representation in the established regime was acutely felt but remained unmet. It was this demand that Chavez promised to fulfill from 1992 onwards, appearing in public as a charismatic leader committed to fulfill the will of popular majorities, to put an end to the corrupt and oligarchic regime, and to pursue the constitution of an empowered democracy. Chavez came forward as the representative of the hidden majority, of the plebs of poor citizens who are black, indigenous, or mestizo, live in the barrios or in the countryside, and were excluded and marginalized under the former Punto Fijo regime. And he sought to mobilize particularly informal labor, a mass contemporary constituency which typically lacks trade union, political, or other organization in most contemporary societies, and was also excluded from official trade unionism in Venezuela. Chavez and his patriotic Pol Alliance managed to win this game of representation and the battle for hegemony in the 1998 presidential elections. At the center of his discourse, Chavez placed firmly the sovereign people, El Pueblo, pitting it against the elites of the Punto Fijo regime, who were accused of betraying and financially ruining the country. His proclaimed objective was regime change and the restoration of popular power. The nodal points of his discourse, which helped to get together diverse social demands and discontents in a common discourse, were the appeal to the people, the notion of protagonistic democracy, and the figure of Chavez himself, who was identified with the people. This discourse and its political project were incarnated thereafter in the new so-called Bolivarian Constitution of 1999. Chavez's language and politics were thus populist in the most classic sense of the term, if we follow at least Laclau's analysis, which defines the politics of populism as, First, the formation of an internal antagonistic frontier separating the people from power. Second, the construction of a change of equivalences among popular demands that are less left unsatisfied by those in power. And this equivalence is produced through common empty signifiers that name and unify this chain of demands. And third, the people of populism is represented as an excluded and disaffected mass of people which claims to be the only legitimate community. Laclau mentions, as we know and we have already mentioned today, a fourth key feature of populism, which is very prominent in the history of populist politics in Latin America and in Chavista populism. And this is the role of the leader. The agency of Chavez acted as a catalyst for the unification of dispersed and heterogeneous groups who had divergent claims and aspirations and no common organization. This catalytic unifying function was enabled by Chavez's charisma, his inflammatory and visionary discourse, and his identification with the people. This can be seen as one of the most important contributions of leadership to the formation of a new political bloc which can pursue a project of social and political transformation in a democratic direction. The case of Chavez demonstrates the effectiveness of populist discourse and strategy in creating a new social and political hegemony under the particular conditions that characterized Venezuelan democracy and society in the 90s. That is, the crisis of democratic representation, social fragmentation, social heterogeneity, and the impotence of social movements. But social mobilization, participation, and citizenship will become autonomous, free from top-down control, and thus more deeply democratic, insofar as leadership becomes gradually less directive, authoritative, and in the end becomes redundant. Chavez, however, did not take this step while he was alive. His eclipse as a political mediator came about in a natural way through his death. It remains thus to be seen if this turn of the events now will help to release new democratic force and developments as the next government, Maduro's government, is confronted with an aggravating economic and political crisis. Today, Venezuelan society is beset by deep cynicism, widespread corruption, persisting class inequalities, a very high criminality rate, political violence, and ongoing brutal clashes between Chavistas and the opposition. The overall record of the achievements and failures of Chavez populism during his term in power suggests that this is a contradictory, conflict-ridden, and many-sided process. To begin with, Chavez government did deliver on some of its main promises of democratization. It promoted participatory democracy and the sociopolitical inclusion of marginalized popular sectors through policies of wealth redistribution and social welfare programs, which benefited a lot from the rise of oil prices. Poverty in Venezuela fell from 50%, almost nearly 50% of the population in 1998 to 19.6% by the end of 2003. Moreover, popular protagonistic democracy, as Chavez called it, was first pursued in the social programs, the so-called misiones, in order to improve and co-manage basic infrastructures in low-income districts. A turning point in this politics of what has been called state-sponsored participatory democracy, that is participatory democracy that is sponsored actively by the state, was the passing of the law for the communal councils and the communes, which are new units of direct self-administration in the localities that are entitled to direct state funding for local projects and were put forward as the fundamental cell of a new communal state structure in which power would flow from the bottom up. Now, on the other hand, the concentration of the whole political process around the person of the leader, an individual leader, has at least three dangers for democratic politics, all of which came true in the case of Chavez. There are not only three, there are many more, but I will focus only on three. The first risk is that an effective concentration of power in the person of the leader and an authoritative hierarchical direction of the block of force that is articulated around him may undermine social self-organization and an egalitarian emancipation of the people. Throughout his term in office from 1998 to 2013, Chavez increased the official powers of the president and also exercised exceptional powers granted to him by the National Assembly. He also determined the fundamental directions of the entire Bolivarian process of social transformation without consultation with the government or the movement. Moreover, he occasionally trampled on basic rules of liberal democracy by personally interfering with formal independent state institutions, such as the judiciary of the state oil company, violating constitutional laws, and the check and balances among different loci of state authority. This is the second major threat that strong populist leadership poses for democratic politics, that is, the subversion of liberal constitutionalism. And this is the standard criticism leveled against populism by liberals who see authoritarian demagogy as the very essence of populist politics. And Chavez has been considered as a model of this kind of politics in our times. The third danger is the dissolution of the Popular Democratic Front into rival factions once the leader that holds it together has vanished, if no organic links have developed meanwhile among the various constituents of the bloc. Such a dispersion and a consequent weakening of the Bolivarian process of change have indeed taken place as a result of Chavez's death and the assumption of leadership by the less charismatic President Nicolas Maduro. Now, I'm running out of time, so unfortunately, I cannot go through what was for me the most important part of this paper, which is the role of the social movement in Chavez populism. It has been argued by many analysts and researchers in the last 5 or 6 years that actually the social movements and grassroots mobilizations have played a much stronger role in the politics of Chavez than is usually acknowledged by this focus and this exclusive concentration on the person of the leader and his own political action and his work or his initiatives in government. The idea is that there was a variety of social forces and social movements from the 80s, from the late 70s until the 90s, that converged around some common ideas, the notion, for instance, of restoring popular sovereignty, the figure of Bolivar as a figure of a national popular leader which is actually fights for national independence, and the idea of direct people democracy and decentralization. These are ideas that were actually assumed, taken over by Chavez and incorporated in his discourse and his project. We also find the idea among activists, and this is what has been reported in a number of interviews, that the idea that Chavez was not the agent or the subject who constructed the whole Bolivarian process and the whole Bolivarian movement, but these movements that pre-existed, Chavez, and the movements that were triggered by his own political intervention, the assumption of power, these movements actually directed his presence and constructed their leader. Now, I have to conclude now, unfortunately, without going through the various details of the diversity of movements that are and different social forces that are part of Chavez's Popular Front. I want to conclude by arguing that as an instance of populist hegemonic politics, Chavismo consists of a heterogeneous mix of forces, agendas, drives, interests, and ideas. Its populist politics is ridden with various conflicts among divergent orientations. The core contradiction lies between the exercise of strong leadership from above and the objective of egalitarian self-management from below. This is a conflict that is internal to Chavismo's proclaimed ideals of radical popular democracy, whereas from a liberal perspective, the key antithesis is between Chavista populism, pluralism, and liberal constitutionalism. The tensions and heterogeneity which mark Chavista populism are largely an effect, in my view, of its transitory nature. In the most basic sense, Chavez came to power on a promise of regime change, which would carry out a transition from the corrupt Punto Fijo regime to a new participatory and protagonistic democracy. In power, this populist movement retained its transitory character as the forces of the old have not died yet and the new has not fully emerged. The inability of broad social forces to shape a coherent collective will, the relative impotence and fragmentation of grassroots movements, a popular culture of inertia, passivity, individual and consumerism, and the persistence of a rentier economy based on the oil rent are all part and parcel of the historical heritage of the former pre-Chavez regime, but has weighed heavily on the Bolivarian process and has co-determined its fate so far. An account of Chavez populism in terms of a contingent and conflictual multiplicity, which coheres around nodal points and a common enemy, can shed light on the ambiguities and the multiple values of Chavismo in contrast to theories which construe populism as the antithesis of pluralism and concentrate exclusively on the agency of the leader. By the same token, it can help to capture the entire gamut of ambiguities inherent in this contradictory diversity, both the demagogic and illiberal dangers, but also the democratic potentials, such as the facilitating function of leaders and state policies which promote civic empowerment. Last but not least, seeing populism as a battlefield of multiple forces and logics whose conflict is open-ended and will be resolved through political struggle itself serves to politicize populism, that is, to open it up to different developments, alliances, and negotiations. And Noah's understanding and politicization of this sort is impeded, in my view, by monolithic constructions which either castigate populism as a doom for contemporary democracy or celebrate it as the definite remedy for the crisis of democracy. So that's all. Thank you.